It's time for Emergence News on Plains FM 96.9, citizen-made radio.
Hello, listeners, and welcome to Emergence News. What an odd title for a radio program, Emergence News. What does that mean? Well, with me today are Peter.
Hi, John.
And Shafia.
Hello.
And let's talk a little bit about what Emergence News means before we move on with our topic for today's program. So I started with the question, who are we? So who are we, Shafia?
So we're a group of global volunteers who are sharing the story of Maitreya and the masters in the world, helping us at this moment too.
Okay, so it's Maitreya's emergence that yes. Emergence News is all about. Okay, Peter.
Yeah, and the masters as well.
And the masters.
Yes.
So if we're Emergence News and it's about the emergence of Maitreya, the world teacher, who's he?
Well, he is the Christ. He is also the Buddha, the fifth Buddha, Buddha Maitreya.
Yes.
And he is the Iman Mahdi.
Yes.
And he's also the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
So he is the teacher for the New Age. That's right. Who he is, and that's the way he prefers to be known.
And he is the avatar for the age of Aquarius.
He is indeed.
Okay. And of course, he has all these priorities, and this is what we talk about.
Yes.
As we see them manifesting on the earth.
Okay, and he's also come to us at a time that is karmic, at a time of human appeal at the end of 1945, and also at a time when we are in dire circumstance. And he comes with some ideas, and he comes with a different approach to life, and he comes to show us the way. So, today's program, we're going to talk about the breaking down of this civilization. And this is a statement, the breaking down of the civilization, that I have become more and more comfortable with. Benjamin Krem, who is the author and the lecturer who we probably refer to most on this program, and is, I guess, the oracle for the emergence of Maitreya, uses this term often. He talks about the breaking down of the civilization. And it works for me because it gives me a context for everything that we see going on with humanity on this planet at the moment. Because if you look at things in isolation, if you look at the state of the health system, if you look at the state of the infrastructure, if you look at the state of violence on the planet, both regionally, locally, and globally, if you look at economic and environmental issues, every one of those in isolation is unfixable. But for me, when we look at it as the breaking down of this civilization, then the fix is change the way we manage the planet as a group. And Maitreya comes with some great ideas about that. So it's not about fixing the details. It's about looking at how we manage this planet. We manage this planet as though it's a commodity, as though it's a resource, as though every blade of grass and every drop of water and every mountain and every forest should generate income, primarily for me. Because we are self-centered and are trying to extract wealth. It is the pursuit of material wealth that is this mindset that humanity's caught up on. Some people caught up on. The New Age, the age of Aquarius, is talking about sharing, is talking about looking at us as one people, is talking about synthesis and unity. I like to think of planet Earth as a spaceship. We are with a flotilla of other spaceships moving through space on a preordained pathway through the cosmos. We have 195 nations on this spaceship. Let's call them crew members, 195 crew members. How are we all getting on here on this spaceship?
Some of us are a bit stroppy with the other ones.
We don't get on.
No.
Really? And we compete, and we argue, and we fight. And one of our roommates on this spaceship spend $780 billion a year on armaments, and he's got them stuffed in his bedroom and the closet's overflowing with weapons. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the arms race and the weapons on this planet, because the biggest industry on planet Earth is not growing food, it's not IT, it's not energy, it's military. The biggest industry on this spaceship is making guns and weapons. So I've gone to the latest Share International, because we're carrying through this, sorry, it's May this year, May 2019 Share International, because we're carrying through this idea of breaking down of this civilization. One of the things that I see as an ingredient for that is this dependence on violence and the tools of violence. And we were talking about the violence on this planet before we came into the studio today. The article's called Preaching World Peace by Day, Peddling Lethal Weapons by Night. And it talks about a sharp increase in arm purchases and being triggered directly or indirectly by several conflicts and civil wars within that kind of Middle East area. It talks about the world's worst humanitarian crisis, which is the military conflict in Yemen, where 5,000 civilians have either been killed or wounded last year. Now, apparently there's an organization in this spaceship called Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, or SIPRI, and they go around gathering information on the movement of arms around this planet. It has identified the five largest arms exporters between 2014 and 2018. They are the United States, Russia, France, Germany, and China. Now, with the exception of Germany, the four of them are permanent members of the UN Security Council, along with the UK, which is number six largest arms exporter on the planet. Together, they account for 75% of the total volume of arms exports on this planet. The Security Council, the most powerful UN body dealing largely with conflict resolution, relentlessly preaches the message of peace to the world at large, while all five of its permanent members are peddling arms and sustaining conflicts in Yemen, Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Libya, and also fueling the long-standing Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So we have, in this crippled spaceship, wobbling through space, 195 crew members. We're talking about the breaking down of this civilization. And on this particular spaceship, the biggest industry is the making of weapons. We have the UN, which is an organization that we're trying to look to manage life on the spaceship. The UN has this UN Security Council, which vetoes actions and activity by the UN under this umbrella of global security. However, five of the permanent members are the biggest sellers of weapons on the planet. Does anybody see a conflict of interest there?
Yes.
I suspect that the UN Security Council is more about selling weapons than selling peace. There's some really disturbing numbers coming out of this article. It's talking about over that same period, 2014 to 2018, Saudi Arabia became the world's largest arms importer. Egypt increased its arms uptake by 206%. Israel by 354%. Iraq by 139%. This is increases in their purchases of arms, which go to five or six nations, five or six roommates on this spaceship we're traveling through space in. Really, really concerning. Peter, what have you got for us?
Well, John, almost on the same line here, this article really from written up by Oliver Stone, the film producer, and he's talking about something that Jimmy Carter recently said, which was profound and damning. The USA is the most warlike nation in the history of the world. He contrasted the USA with China, saying China is building high-speed trains for its people, while USA is putting all its resources into mass destruction. Which, where are the high-speed trains in the USA, he wondered. And the Vice President, Mike Pence, told a recent class at West Point, "It is virtually a certainty that you will fight on a battlefield for America at some point in your life." These are the young recruits going out of the officer, West Point. It was a report of the Pentagon is preparing for a war against both China and Russia, even as Trump and his henchmen are openly threatening war against Iran and Venezuela, doubling down on the nearly 20-year war in Afghanistan, and aiding and abetting Saudi Arabia in its genocidal war in the Yemen. What the Times and other press sources fail to recognize, it is the USA that is the rogue state by any measure. And in two global polls, they rated USA as the greatest threat to world peace. So I've come up a little piece here by the Pope, actually, and he said he's talking about arms sales to Saudi Arabia. "Nations that sell arms to Saudi Arabia have no right to talk about peace," Pope Francis recently said. The statement by the pontiff came in an interview that aired on Sunday, the 31st of March this year. And on the weekly, and this is on the Spanish news, when the presenter asked him about Spain selling the weapons to the kingdom, which is leading the coalition waging catastrophic war on Yemen, Pope Francis expressed sorrow but promptly added that it is not the only government doing that. Spain is just one among the numerous nations that supply arms to Saudi Arabia and continue to do so despite accusations of the coalition committing war crimes and increasing attention on the kingdom's vast human rights abuses following the killing of the journalist Khashoggi. And I mean, that was a pretty horrific thing, but that was only a minor crime in comparison to the peoples that are being killed in Yemen. I mean, the media has focused so much on that one person being killed, and it was terrible. But what about all the terrible...
Yeah, the pictures that are coming out now.
The people, really, you know, so the children and parents and whatnot that have been blown to bits.
And starvation there, is it reaching sort of, you know...
I mean, it's just...
Endemic levels.
It seems a wrong focus, really, for the news media to put so much emphasis on one person when literally hundreds are dying in it every day.
And when we look at this civilization, when we look at the way we're managing this planet... Number one industry is the arms industry. Is this sustainable? Does it make any sense to be living this way? Can we continue? Shafia, you've been travelling in Britain.
I have, yes.
Did you want to talk a little bit about what you saw in Britain as you were travelling there?
Yeah, I mean, I mean, for me, it's very interesting to watch the UK, partly because we know that that's where Maitreya has his base.
Yes.
You know, since 1977, he's been living amongst the Asian community there. And apparently, Benjamin Creme says he chose the UK because of the level of initiates there, the amount of the people there who would really make a difference. And also, he says that they have a very mature parliamentary system, which is interesting, having been there for 3 months, and that they would also they would also be a leader in the world in this new transformation. So, you know, I've always, and having lived there myself for 50 years, I've always been really interested in what's going on and trying to work out how this is actually working, you know. So the last 3 months that I've been there, you know, the political life is just I'm looking at it in astonishment, you know, amazement, because the government, the present Tory government, are just committing human abuses, you know, human rights abuses. And they've actually been told that they're doing this, and they've totally in denial about it. And the way that they're treating the immigrants, you know, the hostile environment for immigrants, they are, you know, cutting funding for disability, for sick people are going in and they're saying them they're fit to work and then they die 4 weeks later.
Austerity measures
are just beyond, and they just, nobody seems to be really fighting against it except the opposition, which is the Labour Party, and they are really coming out every day and sort of, you know, stating about the injustices that are happening. And of course, Brexit's going on. And so, you know, they have this, what I felt was this sort of overriding weariness about Brexit, you know, yeah. 3 years of constant Brexit in the papers. And people are just want to get out, or they don't really care what happens, you know, because it's... just they can't think about what it means or how, or you know, or can't inform themselves because they're just weary, you know. Yeah. And that's the overriding, you know, feeling I got when I was there.
So the politicians in Britain mm-hmm. have
lost the plot.
Yes, have lost the care for the people.
Well, certainly in the Tory Party, you know, mm-hmm. they are. I mean, what Thatcher did, you know, was pretty bad, but they've gone into overdrive, you know, and yeah. it's just really quite distressing to see the stories that are coming
out. So, under the current political system in Britain, who is doing well?
So, Jeremy Corbyn. I mean, he's the leader of the Labour Party, and. You know, I, from my perspective, he would be an initiate, you know,
yes.
just the way he talks, his language is the language of Maitreya. It's about inclusivity, it's about equality, it's about, you know, creating conditions where people can earn enough money to live, mm-hmm. you know, investment. And he's also the only politician that really talks about climate change. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, his party, the Labour Party, pushed for the UK to be the first UK government to say, declare a climate emergency.
Yes.
And also he warns people, he's warning people and saying, you know, we've got these refugees now from war, but we are soon going to be having refugees from climate refugees,
you know.
And these people won't be coming, you know, here to try and make a better life for themselves. They'll be coming because they've got nowhere to live.
Right.
You know, and he's the only one who's standing up and saying it, which is really interesting to listen to, you know,
yeah.
and really just putting that out there as being the number one thing that we need to do. Again, which is very much about what Maitreya says, you know.
Excellent.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the Emergence News on Plains FM. For more information, go to shareinternational.org.
What else did you pick up while you were there, Shafia?
So the good news there, and where I can see, where I can see that maybe, you know, Benjamin Krem was right about the UK becoming the leader for the world is the energy for climate change and for environmental concerns. Extinction Rebellion have done a huge amount over there, mm-hmm. and they are really, you know, in the mainstream media. All the media is talking about it. I stayed with my mother a lot, and she had the television on all the time. There's lots of programs about it. Mm-hmm. Real energy for discussing it and really actually looking at ways of trying to change it. And it made me think, you know, like Jacinda Ardern here has said that she wants, you know, the climate to be our sort of nuclear moment. But yes. actually, I don't feel the energy here for it.
No,
you know,
correct.
as it was in Britain, and I can see yeah. that if they could get Jeremy Corbyn into government, I think that he would really make a difference. He would prioritise it, mm-hmm. and there he could be a leader, because obviously, if we don't have a planet to live on, mm-hmm. everything else is a bit of a moot point, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
So,
is he likely to get in? Do you think?
Well, he's being totally demonised by the media. You know, every day it's poisoned. And, you know, drip, drip, drip. We were talking earlier
against
about all the
Jeremy Corbyn.
Against Jeremy Corbyn, against all the things that he's, I mean, he's a Czech spy, he's a terrorist sympathiser, he's too frail in his yeah. mind and his physical body, you know, yeah. to sort of be prime minister. Everything they can throw at him, they're throwing at him.
Right.
And I think it shows that they're very scared of him, you know, mm-hmm. and because he will counteract the you know, the powers that be, yeah.
right. mm-hmm. So that manipulation of the media in Britain has been really turned on Jeremy Corbyn.
Yeah, definitely, because, you know, and then you know, they will talk about climate change, so, you know, there's this sort of that real polarization thing going on, you know.
Yes.
I think it's the power and the privilege is being threatened, and so they're yes. fighting for that, but yes. also there's this recognition of what is going on in the world, and so it's quite interesting. It's quite a paradox, you know.
That polarization, that is the breaking down of the old civilization,
yes.
and the coming through of the new.
Yes.
And to put it in esoteric terms, it's that Piscean Age withdrawal,
yeah.
and the Aquarian Age coming in.
Yes.
And yeah. that is the competing factions that we're seeing on the planet at the moment.
Yeah.
I'm all right, Jack, and so things should stay the way they are.
Yeah.
And the new voice that's saying, actually,
yeah.
things aren't all right, and it's not all right for everybody.
Yeah, Yeah.
And we should have some equality around that.
That's right.
So the mass media really is like the materialism aspect, isn't it?
Yes.
You know, it's very much their vested interests of whoever owns the newspapers and that sort of thing. They're the materialists who need to control that.
Yes, and the media's client is not the consumer of the media. The media's client is the advertiser.
Yes. The big business, etc.
Right. So anything else you've got for us, Shafia?
So I'd just like to go back to what Benjamin said that about the mature parliamentary system, because this is really interesting for me, because in Parliament you'd see, you would think, gosh, there's no maturity here. But when you watch, you know, apart from people like Jeremy Corbyn, which I'm a great fan of, I have to say.
But it doesn't come across.
It doesn't come across. But what's happening is this sort of real fight for the soul of parliamentary democracy. And so the government are trying to ride roughshod over everything, and then but Parliament is actually fighting back, you know, and so it's going to be really interesting just to watch if they actually succeed in stopping Brexit, which is what they're going to do, or stopping a Brexit no deal, because I think if they do that, then it shows that they're starting to take control back, you know.
So if we have a government, current government in Britain, that is trying to get their own way at all costs, and in the process possibly dismantling that mature parliamentary system, who's fighting for the parliamentary system?
Well, I think a lot of MPs throughout, you know, in Westminster, a lot of the younger MPs, certainly Jeremy Corbyn is, you know, and this new wave of any progressive MPs, and they've stopped it. They've managed to have a majority to stop certain things, like stopping the deal going through.
Right.
So I think that's a sign of where the maturity is.
Yes.
You know, it's not all about the government forcing things through. The Parliament is fighting back, you know.
So it's a parliamentary system that has a robustness and a health independent of the egos of the politicians.
Yes, well, hopefully. I mean, this is what, so it's just going to be fascinating watching how it unfolds, you know. It's
fascinating. Watch the decline of one civilization and the rise of another.
Yes, it is. And of course, the rising is always coming from the grassroots.
And the young.
And the young. And yes, there was
Go Greta Thunberg.
That's right. Great Greta Thunberg.
Okay, so Peter, we're going to come back to you and pick up and let you finish us off. All right, Peter, I'm going to throw to you to bring the show home. What have you got for us?
Well, I've got message number 11 from Maitreya through Benjamin Cram.
That's coming from the book?
Yes, it is indeed.
140 messages from Maitreya?
Yes, messages from Maitreya the Christ.
I love that book.
My dear friends, I am happy to be with you once more. My plan is that my teaching should precede my presence and prepare my way. My people will release it through their groups and group endeavour. When mankind is somewhat prepared, my voice shall be heard. Meanwhile, my efforts are bearing fruit, producing change, drawing together men and nations, bringing new hope to the world. I am emerging soon, but first I would point the way into the new direction which man, if he would survive, must take. Firstly, men must see themselves as brothers, sons of the one Father. This is essential if they would progress one step nearer the Godhead. Throughout the world there are men, women, and little children who have not even the essentials to stay alive. They crowd the cities of many of the poorest countries in the world. This crime fills me with shame. My brothers, how can you watch these people die before your eyes and call yourself men? My plan is to save these, my little ones, from certain starvation and needless death. My plan is to show you that the way out of your problems is to listen again to the true voice of God within your hearts, to share the produce of this most bountiful of worlds among your brothers and sisters everywhere. I need your help. I call on you to aid me in my task. How can I stand aside and watch this slaughter, watch my little ones die? No, my friends, this cannot be. Therefore, I am come quickly amongst you once more to show you the way, point the path. But the success of my mission depends on you. You must make the choice. whether you share and learn to live peacefully as true men or perish utterly. My heart tells me your answer, your choice, and is glad. May the divine light and love of the one most holy God fall upon your hearts and minds. May this light, love, and power lead you to seek that which dwells in silence within you. Find that and know that you are God's.
All this information can be found on the Share International website, www.share-international.org. Scorpio Books in Christchurch carries the magazine and some books. And also don't forget the podcasts, which are available on the Plains FM website.
We welcome your comments, questions and feedback. Please contact us at emergencenews@gmail.com.
The opportunity to join our transmission is available Monday and Wednesday evenings and Thursday mornings, which gives us the possibility to do a service meditation in conjunction with Masters.